Now, why would God just raise up a handful of people that he's only going to reveal himself so they can glow in the dark? The whole purpose of God showing favor upon anyone would be for the purpose of them being used and be a first fruit, be like a first fruit company, which is going to what? Serve the purpose of bringing in multitudes. A multitude that no man can number. Okay? So we have associated, we basically have associated, quote, numbers, multitudes, big churches with some kind of watered down gospel in the sense that has really been true. But I'm telling you, a day is coming where you're going to see mega churches that are not going to be preaching a watered down gospel, but they are going to be preaching the fullness of the kingdom of God.
As Jesus said in Matthew 24, when this gospel of the kingdom
shall be preached to all nations
as a witness unto me.
Yeah.
That's what's going to be seen in those mega churches.
And see,
I believe it.
You're studying, of course you're studying the tabernacle of Moses, right?
Yes,
which
sir.
What you're seeing is that you're not just learning a bunch of facts. I hope that's not where the emphasis is, and I don't think it is.
No.
You're not just, there is a significance to all of these measurements. There is a significance to all of this intricate detail.
Yes.
Okay? And the significance is that it is speaking about a spiritual truth. It's not just about some natural construction back in the Old Testament. Okay? And so, the revelation of God is going to bring forth a great ingathering. In fact, and you probably touched on this, I would think, at some point in time, you've probably been exposed to Passover, Pentecost, Tabernacles, Outer Court, Holy Place, Holy of Holies, right?
Mm-hmm.
Passover was fulfilled at the brazen altar, which represented the blood, right? Pentecost associated with the holy place, which was a spirit-filled arena, where there was a golden candlestick that was fueled with the anointing oil, okay? And then the table of showbread, which represented the word of God, healing. And then the altar of incense, which represented spiritual praise and worship to God. All of that's in the spirit, what we call the spirit-filled arena. You follow?
Mm-hmm.
But then there's another experience, which is behind
the veil,
the
holy place,
where where the mercy seat is, not the judgment seat, but the mercy seat.
Yes.
Okay. Where the glory of God, where the Shekinah glory of God was the light. See, the light of the outer court was the sun. The light of the holy place was a candlestick.
Mm-hmm.
The light of the most holy is the glory of God, the Shekinah glory of God. Okay, so when you associate these three feasts, Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles with those different components of the Tabernacle of Moses, which again typifies what? Salvation through the blood of Jesus. Feast of Pentecost was literally fulfilled on the day of Pentecost when the Spirit of God came as a rushing mighty wind filled the place where they were, right? When the day of Pentecost was fully come. So, spiritually speaking, the Feast of Pentecost was fulfilled in that experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
You follow? So then the question is, what is going to be the spiritual fulfillment of the Feast of Tabernacles? Well, among many other things, I believe that it represents, tabernacles really represents like the ingathering. In fact, the Feast of Ingathering was part of the Feast of Tabernacles. Why am I saying all of this? It's because associated with that third great experience, we hear about the third day experience or you know, threefold thing, that one of the things associated with this Feast of Tabernacle experience is going to be a great in-gathering. Which I say that there, have you understand there are millions and millions, maybe even billions of religious folks?
Sure. Oh yeah.
But then it narrows down when you talk about Christianity. It narrows down even more when you're talking about the blood of Jesus or in that experience. And guess what? It narrows down even more when you talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
Sure.
Okay? So it would sound like it would be logical that there's going to be a narrowing down more of those who enter into that third dimension. And in one sense of the word, it may, and that may be the remnant, you see. But as a result of that remnant coming into that experience, it's going to be for the salvation of multitudes.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Has to be.
And that's the reason why I say that in one sense, word, I believe that's what the great ingathering of the Jews is going to represent. It's going to represent a part of that ingathering, of that experience. And even though that I've been accused of being anti-Semitic, you know, you could say Jew bashing. I'm not a Jew basher and I'm not anti-Semitic. I'm just pro Jesus.
Yes.
I'm pro Calvary, you know, the blood, salvation through faith, by grace. I'm a proponent of that.
Yes, sir.
I'm not the opponent of anybody. Okay? I am not the opponent to the natural Jews. I'm just simply saying that the favor of God, the blessings and the anointing of God is upon a remnant who are the seed of Abraham by faith, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which we identify with as the church.
Yep.
And so in all, for all practical purposes, all of the promises that were made in the natural to a natural nation of Israel were really intended to be completely fulfilled through the church. But the dispensations say there's no mention of the church in the Old Testament, right? Okay, guess what? We're not going to finish lesson 9 because we probably only got about a tenth of the way through. So what we're going to do, I'm going to try to kind of bring us to some kind of conclusion here. And next week I'll say, okay, this is session 10.
Continue a
continuation of lesson 9.
Okay. Back to the pattern.
Okay. So here's a statement. If it's through a remnant, no church or nation is saved en masse, meaning that you're not saved as a whole. In other words, everybody, just because you associate yourself with Cedar Lake Christian Center, does not mean you're everybody that associates themselves or identifies themselves with Cedar Lake Christian Center are going to be saved.
And the same thing, here, no.
Just because you are a member of a particular race or a particular nationality does not mean that everybody of that race and everybody of that nation is going to be saved or is going to be exclusively identified with the plan and purpose of God. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
That it's not going to be based on any church, it's not going to be based on any nation or nationality or race. The relationship with God is not, you could say that the purposes of God are being expressed through a corporate body, right?
Yes.
But a relationship, you don't speak about a relationship with God as being a group of people's relationship
with
God.
It's
an individual, personal relationship. So, the favor of God, the calling of God, is going to be placed upon individuals who have believed the gospel. God does not call men in crowds. He calls us individually, one by one. You don't have to write down all of this, okay? Man is not saved by being a member of any nation or family or church. He is saved because he has made a personal decision for God. So we want to make a note just simply say this, that our relationship with God is individual. Based yes. on how we avail ourselves to the salvation of the Lord. Now, there was a faithful remnant. There is to this day a faithful remnant, I believe, and you could, maybe you could call them Messianic Jews. And I mean, a Messianic Jew is basically what?
One who believes in Christ.
Okay, believes in the Messiah. They believe their Messiah has come, right?
All Jews believe there is a Messiah. They just, most of them don't believe he's already
come. Messianic Jews have accepted Jesus as their Messiah.
As the Messiah.
All right. So the real remnant, in one sense word, I guess you could say, are the Messianic Jews.
That's good. That's good.
They're the true Jews.
The true remnant.
The true Jew is one who is
a believer in Christ.
A believer. He's not a Jew who is one outwardly.
But one.
Neither is a circumcision that of the flesh, but of the heart. Okay? For if they're being cast away is the reconciling of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? For if the first fruit is holy, the lump is also holy. So the first fruit there is speaking about the original blessed nation.
It's 12:15. Is this 12:15? Romans 12:15?
Is that 15?
Or
11:15, I believe.
11:15.
Yeah. Yes, 11:15. Yeah. So we're not even getting close to chapter 12 yet. And if some of the branches were broken off, and you being a wild olive tree were grafted in among them, and with them became a partaker of the root and fatness of the olive tree. Apparently I didn't complete all of that. How are the Jews going to be saved?
By belief in Jesus.
By belief in Jesus.
Same way we are.
Yeah. Same way as anyone.
How did we become a part of that olive tree?
By being grafted through our faith.
So how are the Jews going to be?
Same way.
By the same way.
Okay. I mean, that's the bottom line. And really what Paul is doing here, he's warning the Gentiles not to be cocky, arrogant, thinking, well, you know, God shown favor to us and we believed and he's just simply saying, hey, don't get too high and mighty, because, you know, you could, well, first of all, it's by the grace of God that they were even grafted in, which really says what? It's not based on whether you kept the meticulous details of the law, but whether you had faith in the saving Jesus grace of the Lord
Christ,
Jesus Christ.
Right.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, I don't know.
Go ahead.
I just think if as the Gentiles, God sort of, in a way, hardened sort of the Jews, he just sort of, I don't know, but that allowed the Gentiles to become the belief in faith. To have faith.
And open the door to the
door.
Gentiles.
So in sort of a backwards way, the Jews are going to see what it's done for the Gentiles, and then they're going to come back to the way the Gentiles are.
And that's basically, I think, what Paul is saying.
I do too.
But then you have to say, well, is that just going to be for whatever generation is going to be alive at that time? You see?
Yeah.
You know, if that be the case, and I'm just throwing this out, it's been 2,000 years that has passed. So, is just what's going to happen in one generation?
It's going to be like a pattern?
I think the answer is in Scripture, but maybe we ought to. I think we talked about that a little bit off camera last week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying? In other words, it has to be more than just one little generation in the year 2000.
The grace of God is the grace of God is the grace of God.
Yeah. So Paul basically has two words. The first word is a word of warning, and that is a word of warning to who?
Well, the Jews.
To the Gentiles.
Yeah.
Don't get overconfident.
Yeah, exactly. And then the second is a word of hope, and that word of hope is what?
For the Jews.
Okay, word of hope is, see, first of all, it's a word of warning.
See, why it's there for the Gentiles and act on it.
Exactly. All right. And so all Israel will be saved as it is written. The deliverer will come out of Zion, and he will turn away ungodliness from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sake, but concerning the election, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers, for the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. Revocable, or as King James says, the old King James says, are without repentance, which just simply means God. It's not like that God said, you know, I made a mistake and I'm really sorry that I called you or that I placed my gifts in you. For as you were once disobedient to God, yet have now obtained mercy through their disobedience. This is so rich, and this is really, it ought to be simple, and I guess when you get the revelation of it, it is. But this is some pretty deep stuff.
Yeah, really is.
Now listen to this. For as you, he's speaking to the Gentiles here. For as you were once disobedient to God, yet you've obtained mercy through their disobedience. Even so, these also have now been disobedient, and they in turn will receive mercy. Isn't that what he's saying? He said, look, you were disobedient, you obtained mercy, and so now their disobedience is going to result in mercy. For God has committed them all to disobedience that he might have mercy on all. If you never knew what sin was, you'd never know what salvation is.
Sure.
If you never knew what captivity was, you never know what deliverance and freedom and liberty is. If you never knew what evil was, you wouldn't know what good is. If you really never knew what it meant to be disobedient to God, you wouldn't understand what the mercy of God is. Now here is really the conclusion. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Mm-hmm. Now, does that mean that you'll never know the will of God? No. It just simply means that if you're trying to figure this out in your natural carnal mind, forget it. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Listen to this. Oh, the depth of the riches, well, let's repeat it. Yeah, I guess I just repeat myself there. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has known the mind of the Lord? Who can know the mind of the Lord?
Only those who seek after him spiritually.
Only those who take on the mind of the Lord. That's... What is it, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that speaks about, I think it's basically saying the same thing. So, or who has become his counselor? Can you question God? Can you question anything that God has done? No. Are you wise enough? Are you smart enough, intelligent enough?
No.
No. Or who has first given to him, and it shall be repaid to him. For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. And that really, really summarizes it. I beseech, well, we'll just wait on this. This is starting at chapter 12, and we are going to try to catch up. Of course, we lost a few minutes at the beginning of class, but... I think we've hopefully we sufficiently covered chapter 11. Not totally, but hopefully that we've understood the gist of it. Father, we do thank you for your truth. We thank you for the love of God. Thank you that we can have the mind of Christ, that we can be transformed by the renewing of our minds, that we can think the way God thinks. We can only think as God thinks as we have the mind of God, the mind of Christ through the Holy Spirit. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. Go in peace. Have a great rest of this day, and we will see you the next time.
Grace and peace and mercy be multiplied.